Welcome, brothers and sisters. Thank you for joining me in my relentless pursuit of building treasures in heaven. Today is October 12th. According to the Gregorian calendar, it is 2016. I wish I could just say the year. I do. I really do. It's one of those things. I'm not sure if that's the case, but here we are. Everybody here knows basically what time it is and where we live, essentially. It is about 6:15 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and I haven't really been proliferating videos lately because there's been a lot of changes that my family's going through. My wife and myself, our son, he's just along for the ride. He's a year old. But we're changing a lot of things about our lives and our lifestyle, and trying to change things that we would rather have different. That on top of, I suppose on top of new information that's come to light and other things that I'm having to deal with personally, has made it to where I'm just not able to make as many videos as I'd like, I suppose. But I would prefer that the videos that I made were of a higher quality than quantity. Some of the things I'm going to start real quick and tell you about something that's going on here so that you're well aware. First off, because I intend on being nothing but transparent with the people that I would communicate with, assuming that most of you that I'm talking to are in fact my brothers and sisters in our Lord Jesus Christ. So I've mentioned before that I do have cancer. It's lymphoma. It's not per se an extremely aggressive form of lymphoma. There's about 90 different forms of lymphoma. So it's called follicular lymphoma. The only thing is, I also have something called ITP, and I've probably had it my whole life because of the way things were when I was a kid. It seems obvious that I've probably had it my whole life. ITP, the long name is idiopathic thrombocytopenia. And what's happening is, I don't normally have very many platelets in my blood, and the spleen tends to attack platelets. And the only upside to it all is that I have very abnormal platelets, which a lot of people with ITP do. They're abnormally large, so it sort of makes up for what's going on with my spleen, but all of it being essentially part of the lymphatic system. So it's all linked together in a way. besides the very well-founded mistrust that I have and now my wife has for the allopathic means of medicine, which is the it's the entrenched status quo medicine of today. In fact, there's many things that are homeopathic that are illegal for people to do or practice or experiment on or to gain more knowledge and wisdom on, because those things are actually effective. So one of the problems that we have is that because of the ITP specifically, we have been very negative about using chemo specifically, and there's so much bad about radiation, and surgery tends to just spread things depending. So we're really staying away from establishment medicine as much as we can. It would be a last resort. We have no reason to trust establishment medicine. And in fact, with cancers like lymphoma, when you get them treated via the accepted legal procedures of establishment allopathic medicine, lymphoma is more likely, it is almost a guarantee that it'll reoccur. So we've been trying a lot of all-natural therapies. And I would have to say with little success, just because the one predominant lymph node, which has been swelling under one of my arms, has gotten really out of hand. It's pretty bad now. It's just causing an enormous amount of pain, discomfort, and psychologically, it's uncomfortable. I mean, you can see it very clearly. It's not good. But, so here's one of the biggest difficulties in all of this. And I know a lot of people, when I say this, will probably shake their head and they will think, what a ridiculous person I am. And I would say probably rightly so. I've never really denied that I'm an extraordinarily ridiculous person and weak. And in fact, all of the battles that I have won thus far in my walk with Christ and before God, any of those things that I have been able to overcome were not of me. They were all of God. Those people that have an extremely Pelagian mindset concerning these things, well, although I do encourage and we should encourage one another to walk in ways that are good and that are holy and that are honoring to our God and our Lord, I have to tell you straight out that any of the victories I have are not because of me or my strength or resolve. They're because of the strength of God and the Holy Spirit. So, here's my thing. Although follicular lymphoma is one of the very few cancers that cannot be directly linked by the medical establishment to smoking, I still have been struggling with not being able to quit smoking cigarettes. And it has been one of the toughest things as I try to put them off constantly and constantly. I've been unable to. Now, in the book of James, chapter 5, it says that the prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. And the people at the congregation that we go to, they're aware of what's going on with me. And there are those who pray for me. And there are those who are righteous among them. And so I appreciate their prayers. But any of you out there that would feel moved to pray for me, first, that God would give me the strength to win this victory too, because there is victory in Christ, we can live a life that is good and righteous and holy before God our Father. I know this for a fact because he's delivered me from so much lust and so many appetites. It's a fact. And this is simply another thing that I wish to be sanctified from. It is, the way I look at it is like this. In the same way with sexual immorality and lust, this body is not our own. It is, in fact, if you've been redeemed, it is owned by Christ. And it was created by God. So, the owner of my physical body is Christ and God. And there seems to be enough independent evidence showing that the carcinogens and pollutants in the smoke from cigarettes is very damaging to our physical system. So, therefore, it's my dog. I think she's going crazy, scratching. Shh. This mic picks up really good. So, that's my issue. And there you have it. So, that's just one initial thing. I'm sorry I had to start out with that because I'm not too proud to tell people what my problems are or what I'm struggling with. And I have gone to those who are acting as elders in the congregation that I'm in. And I'm going to be talking to another one here in a few days about this, because yes, it has been suggested to me by somebody else there, perhaps I should act accordingly to James 5 in calling for the elders. Is there anyone among you sick? Call for the elders that they may anoint him with oil and pray for him. And if he is sick, he will be healed. His sins, if he has them, will be forgiven. For the prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. And I agree. I very much agree. But at the same time, I want to deal with this thing first. If it is having a bearing on the other, I do not expect the other to be taken care of before this first thing is taken care of. So that's my chief issue right now. So thank you for listening to that. And today we are going to section 2 of Anatomy of a Con Job. And this middle section right here is going to be a little bit of sort of a build-up to the next section, but still a great deal to be said about it. All right, so con number 2, oil is not a fossil fuel. It is renewable. The immigration officer at Sheremetyevo took my passport and studied it for some time. He didn't say anything. He just thumbed through the passport and then looked at a computer screen for a couple of lifetimes before stamping it and grunting me onto customs. The KGB was still manning the borders the first time I went to Moscow shortly after the fall of communism, letting Americans walk freely into Mother Russia without official surveillance was driving the man crazy, but he had to keep a lid on it. In fact, communism had been officially dead for only a few months when the shock troops of capitalism started storming the gates of opportunity in the former Soviet Union. The ghosts of Marx, Lenin, and Stalin stalk the halls of the Politburo in horror as the entrepreneurs from the United States, Japan, and Western Europe tried to cut deals for every last asset in Mother Russia that wasn't nailed down. Banking, hospitality, timber, and precious metals came under assault by peculiar partnerships of Western capitalists and thugs from the once mighty KGB during those early years when Yeltsin, God love him, and his vodka were in office. It was a free-for-all. The Oklahoma land rush of the 1890s had nothing on Moscow in 1992. But even then, the oil industry stayed under control of the state, directly or indirectly. In fact, as recently as 2003, the bare-chested former KGB colonel and current premier, soon to be president of Russia, again, Vladimir Putin, squashed a buyout deal between Russia's Yukos and Exxon, the largest company in the world. To understand the reason for this, we return momentarily to the early days of the Cold War, when an isolated Soviet Union tasked their top scientists to identify the actual source of oil. Not a weekend homework assignment. After considerable research in 1956, Russian scientist Professor Vladimir Porfiriev announced that crude oil and natural petroleum gas have no intrinsic connection with biological matter originating near the surface of the earth. They are primordial, originating with the earth's formation, materials which have been erupted from great depths. If your eyeballs didn't fall out when you read that, you might want to read it again. And I'm going to. Okay. In 1956, Russian scientist Professor Vladimir Porfiriev announced that crude oil and natural petroleum gas have no intrinsic connection with biological matter originating near the surface of the earth. They are primordial, originating with the earth's formation, materials which have been erupted from great depths. He said oil doesn't come from anything biologic, not as conventional wisdom dictates, from the fossilized remains of dinosaurs and or ancient plant matter. It comes from very deep in the earth and is created by a biochemical reaction that subjected hydrocarbons, elements having carbon and hydrogen, to extreme heat and intense pressure during the earth's formation. Russians referred to this oil, any oil really, as abiotic oil, because it is not created from the decomposition of biological life forms, but rather from the chemical process continually occurring inside the earth. I know, easy for Porfiriev to say, but it turns out it was more than just a theory. Because shortly after the Russians discovered this, they started drilling ultra-deep wells and finding oil at 30,000 and 40,000 feet below the earth's surface. That's 6 to 8 miles. These are staggering depths and far below the depth at which organic matter can be found, which is 18,000 feet. So around 3 miles is the deepest that organic matter can be found. Interesting, eh? The Russians applied their theory of abiotic deep drilling technology to the Dnieper Donets Basin. I'm going to call it the Dnieper Donets Basin. It's Dnieper hyphen Donets, Donets, Dnieper Donets Basin, an area understood for the previous half century to be barren of oil. Of 60 wells drilled there using abiotic technology, 37 became commercially productive, a 62% success rate compared with the roughly 10% success rate of a U.S. wildcat driller. The oil found in the basin rivaled Alaska's North Slope. Let's say they had a good hair day. But it doesn't stop there. Not by a long shot. Since their earlier discoveries, the major Russian oil companies have quietly drilled more than 310 ultra-deep wells and put them into production. Result? Russia recently overtook Saudi Arabia as the planet's largest oil producer. Or the plain's largest oil producer. Maybe they are onto something. Though there were papers written on this early on, almost all were in Russian, and few made it to the West, and those that did were laughed at. Is this sounding familiar for any of you who did listen to all of those videos I made reading the book, The Guide to the Phantom Dark Ages? Emmett Scott said the same thing about Heribert Illig's work on the 300 inserted years of phantom time, and how, funny enough, virtually none of it was translated into any other language than German, and almost none into English. As Emmett Scott put it, it was death by silence. Looks like the same thing here. No more. With Russia's rejection of the Exxon-Yukos deal, Putin did not want this technology and their abiotic oil exports exported to the West. And the access to information now available on the internet, the word has begun to spread rapidly to the West. Still, it hasn't taken hold yet. Why not? This is huge. Oil is not a fossil fuel. It is renewable. Wow. There are a couple of factors at play here. Now, these are the factors that the man writing this, John Wolfe, is aware of. And after I read through this, we're going to talk about some more factors that are a lot bigger. So now, real quick, an aside. Anyone who is asking maybe the question, so what exactly does this have to do with the topic that I brought up and said that I was going to stay on indefinitely a few weeks ago, which is the deceptions of the end times beasts? Well, I think it has quite a lot to do with it, and we're going to go into that here momentarily. So to continue, Wolf goes on to say, Big Oil has a vested interest in pushing the idea that oil is scarce, hard to find, and thus costly to produce, all of which, of course, means increased revenues and profits. This is a story in itself, but not the primary focus here. More relevant to our story is the fact that a cornerstone of the environmental movement is this. Now, this is important because, as we can see with the Pope Francis's encyclical that he put out last year, the cornerstone of his encyclical, too, was point one that Wolf brings up, sustainable growth and the environment and man's effect on the environment. So this is very important. Okay. Now, I'm going to pick back up here, paragraph two. More relevant to our story is the fact that a cornerstone of the environmental movement is this. Oil is a fossil fuel that is scarce and is in limited and ever decreasing supply. And one more time, just to really drive it home, a cornerstone of the environmental movement is this, or the cornerstone of their movement is this. It is that oil is a fossil fuel that is scarce and is in limited and ever decreasing supply. Moreover, its production creates carbon dioxide. Therefore, its use for virtually all productive purposes agricultural production, real estate construction, auto, truck, train, and air transportation, utilities, heating, cooling, communication, ad infinitum, all of them must be curtailed. According to the 30-year update of the book, The Limits to Growth, a prime example of a non-renewable resource is fossil fuels, whose limits should be obvious, although many people, including distinguished economists, are in denial over the elementary fact. More than 80% of year 2000 commercial industry and energy use comes from non-renewable fossil fuels, oil, natural gas, and coal. The underground stocks of fossil fuels are going continuously and inexorably down. Peak gas production will certainly occur in the next 50 years. The peak for oil production will occur much sooner, probably within the decade. Scary stuff, frightening, but as false as a hooker's smile. Oil is not a fossil fuel, and it is renewable. While I have never been a fan of Putin the macho, the Russians have demonstrated the accuracy of their theory in the only place it counts, the oil field. Oil is not only abiotic, it continues to populate fields that were understood to be as dry of petroleum as a desert wind. In fact, some scientists believe it is the centrifugal force of the planet's rotation that forces abiotic oil towards the planet's surface on a continuous basis. I would have an issue with that, since I don't believe that we live on a planet. That's me. That's not John Wolfe speaking. That's John McTemus. There are some things the general public does not need to know, and shouldn't. I believe democracy flourishes when the government can take legitimate steps to keep its secrets, and when the press can decide whether to print what it knows. The late Catherine Graham, owner of the Washington Post. That's a chilling quote. So, con number two is that oil is a fossil fuel, which it isn't. That it is scarce and being depleted, which it isn't. That it is non-renewable, which it isn't. And that as a result, catastrophe looms, which it doesn't. Unless we drastically curtail our use of petroleum. Lies, one and all, which lead us to the granddaddy of con. Con number three. And we'll get to that in the next video. But I would like to bring up a few things. First off, like I just said, the Pope's encyclical in 2015, Laudato Si, is echoing these very same things. Now, if we can demonstrably prove these things to be false, sustainable growth, oil as a non-renewable fossil fuel, and other things, man's ill effect on his environment, then we can know that everything the Pope is saying in Laudato Si is all based on a lie, and you better believe the Pope knows about it all. We went over the fact that he was the ranking cardinal in Argentina during the Argentinian Dirty War, and there is no way that he didn't both A, know about all of the atrocities being perpetrated on the people of Argentina, but that he was directly involved and complicit in it. That's why he's Pope now. It's a promotion because of his efforts in the Dirty War. And that's that. Now, real quick, I'd like to go to this article, which was linked off of another blog site that I just found out about recently. I'm not in love with the name of it, but the materials that he has are quite diverse, quite interesting, and are all focused on the source of much of the problem. And when I say much of the problem, what I mean is the people and organization at the top that's disseminating all of these lies and all of this pain and misery, this system we find ourselves sinking further and further into. They are the architects of it, but I will not blame them for our plight altogether. For if we would just repent and turn to the Lord, believe His word, and live it, all of these things that these people are doing, they would matter to us not at all. Consider the fact that when Tupper Saucy wrote his book, The Rulers of Evil, his general attitude was simply just a reflection of what Paul tells Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 1, when he says that the law is for the lawless. And what Saucy had said many times over was that these rulers of evil are there to rule over evil people. So on to this, it's called the five myths of the peak oil theory, and I'm going to run through them pretty fast because there's other things I want to get to that are very important. It says, in 2008, after doing additional research, I realized that the peak oil theory had huge flaws. It relies on the following five myths. Myth number one, oil is a fossil fuel and as such is a finite resource. Western science has brought into and taught the fossil fuel myth regarding petroleum for many years. Researcher/author William Engdahl wrote, Western geologists do not bother to offer hard scientific proof of fossil origins. They merely assert it as a holy truth. The Russians have produced volumes of scientific papers, most in Russian. The dominant Western journals have no interest in publishing such a revolutionary view. Careers, entire academic professionals are at stake, after all, as is the sale of many books. In an interview, Colonel Fletcher Prouty, former government insider, explain the events surrounding the decision to categorize oil as an organic substance, fossil fuel. He points out that it was deceptively made at a World Scientific Conference in Geneva back in the 1892 as a result of pressure exerted by scientists employed by oil magnate John D. Rockefeller. They have never found a fossil fuel below 16,000 feet, and today oil is frequently mined at depths of 30,000 feet. This fallacy was cemented into fact in the early 70s during the energy crisis when globalists John Rockefeller IV and Henry Kissinger convinced top U.S. government officials that a world price needed to be established for the finite resource, oil. And then they have a link to Colonel Prouty's 8 minutes interview, and it is quite telling. But to continue with the text, modern petroleum science has disproven the oil comes from fossils theory many years ago. As Dr. J.F. Kenney revealed in this interview on NPR, it was never more than a theory anyways. And there's links to all of these things, by the way. But because the industry still enjoys a depletion allowance and the U.S. government under the Nixon administration created the petrodollar, Modern petroleum science has been suppressed. Legitimate critics of geologist M.K. Hubbard's oil peak bell curve have also been marginalized and even ignored. And before we go on to myth number two, this is coming from John McTemus, not the author of this blog that we're reading. This whole idea of the petrodollar and limited oil and the value that it gives the dollar and the value that the thought that it's a fossil fuel and is limited is much of the force that was directly behind all of the lies and intrigue that went into the murder of Libya's president, premier, Gaddafi, Colonel Gaddafi. There's a lot to that, that if you got your information from mainstream news sources, you missed. You should look into that. It says a lot concerning the dollar, concerning oil, concerning those who control such things, concerning the United States' role in world affairs, and the old beast who seems not to be, yet is, at the heart of it all. On with the blog. Myth number two, government reported supply / production figures are relatively accurate and reliable. That's a myth. Many have long recognized that U.S. government statistics are managed / manipulated for political reasons. Therefore, their accuracy is suspect. A few examples. Economic. Cost of living and unemployment figures are manipulated and or misrepresented. Flu statistics. Number of deaths each year are grossly exaggerated, and CDC H1N1 statistics have been proven bogus. And there's links for all of these things. Inaccuracy of NASA global temperature figures. You bet. Okay, few peak oil proponents wish to acknowledge that all government agencies are political. The head of these agencies are carefully selected by the executive branch and report directly to the president. Go figure. If his political agenda isn't carried out, the director of the agency is removed and replaced. Hence, we don't get real science from government agencies. We get political science. You better believe it. Myth number three, the market price for oil is a legitimate indicator of oil supply and demand. Correct. The market manipulation by the unholy alliance between the oil industry, Wall Street, and our government was brilliantly exposed by author James Norman in his book, The Oil Card. Mr. Norman, who also exposed Enron's stock market manipulation, used his expertise to research COMEX / NYMEX in the oil market. He discovered the same dishonest practices used by the Enron folks have been replicated to manipulate the price of a barrel of oil for political reasons. Myth number four, exploration and discoveries have slowed or stopped because there is no more oil to find. When Dr. Colin Campbell, I went to school with Colin Campbell, wonder if it's the same one, reports that there have been few oil discoveries since the 60s. He neglects to mention that the industry actually capped off massive oil discoveries in Alaska. Huh. Author Lindsay Williams exposed the discovery and capping of the massive Gull Island oil fields in his book, The Energy Non-Crisis. Here's a link to that, by the way. This fact was verified by former Senator of Colorado, Hugh Chance. It is only one example of supply destruction that has occurred to control oil availability and price for this scarce resource, for which the oil cartel gets a depletion allowance. Additionally, few, if any, academics understand the corporate tax structure behind the oil depletion allowance. Also, many peakists don't bother to mention the Bakken oil field discovery in the western United States that is taking off like a shot, and it's huge. It's huge. They've got a link to this, too, on the Bakken oil field discovery. There's tons of oil. Oil like normal people can't possibly even imagine is available. This idea that we're going to be peaking any time that we could even imagine is utter nonsense. Myth number 5, corruption has little impact on the oil market. Right. Many books have been written on this topic, such as The Oil Card, Stock Market Manipulation, The Energy Non-Crisis, International Limitation of Oil Supplies, and See No Evil, Corrupt CIA/Oil Company Alliance. Now that's the book that I'm going to put on my bucket list to get, See No Evil. Perhaps the most important expose on corruption in the oil industry is Gary Allen's The Rockefeller File. The Rockefeller family has done more to control and corrupt the oil industry than any other force, and Mr. Allen offers enough documentation to indict them. Unfortunately, our current justice system seems to be non-functioning regarding powerful families and corporate crimes. And then two related links he's got is the Gulf oil spill, Peak Oil, and the INC, the beast. Not quite, but okay. Oil is not a fossil fuel, it's renewable. And I would say, you know what, it's interesting that he should call that the beast, and that a number of people call these things the beast, because what we understand to be the beast from Revelation, those with a historicist mind when looking into eschatology in the book of Revelation and Daniel, we have to admit that the beast is a kingdom. A beast is always a kingdom. So we have two beasts revealed to us in Revelation 13. The first one was the kingdom that Daniel first saw in Daniel chapter 7, the fourth kingdom of the earth, obviously the pagan Roman Empire. And then we see it again in Revelation 13. And by the time we see it again in Revelation 13, it has become the papal Roman Empire. Now, I find this interesting that between Daniel and Revelation, we can see this beast in all of the forms that it has taken historically. We see it in Daniel as the pagan Roman Empire. We see it in Revelation 13 as the papal Roman Empire, with basically what we're seeing is the Holy Roman Empire there, what it morphed into, the same beast, but the beast has morphed into the Holy Roman Empire. You have the horns with the crowns atop them. You have a head that seemed wounded unto death. In Daniel 7, we see that one of those horns that had sprouted up was more stout than its fellows, that before it three fell. We can identify the papacy from that. Then we carry it on to Revelation chapter 13, understanding that within this beast system, as we understand from Daniel 7, that the typification of this system is still going to be the papacy. But the papacy and the pope is not the beast. He is very similar to what Nebuchadnezzar was to Babylon. There is an influx to the papacy and its system from the beast, but he is not the beast. The beast is not a man, the beast is a kingdom. And then when we fast forward onto Revelation 17 and 18, the woman riding the beast, then we have the apostate Catholic Church and all of her prostitute daughters. Making up this woman who has aligned herself with the state. Woman riding the beast, church and state, unholy alliance. And this beast, of course, is different that we see in Revelation 17 and 18, scarlet colored. We don't see any crowns necessarily, and all of that. So I find that very interesting, the ways that we are given views of this beast, and what all factors and interests and organizations go into this beast. Naturally, I would have to say that the Vatican's militant arms, they all contribute to the power that this beast holds and wields, that the black nobility that supported the Jesuits and other nefarious organizations, they factor into this heavily. Those who have chosen to be the public face of all of these nefarious hidden hand acts by the Catholic Church and their arms, and all of this black nobility of Europe and everything. These are the ones who, like with the papacy and everything that you see out in the public from them and the Jesuits and everything, that is, of course, their public face. But in private, they are black and white, different than what we know and hear of them in public. Well, in a similar way, you are never going to hear about most of the Jesuits, the movements of the Knights of Malta, Opus Dei, Knights of the Golden Circle, all of these organizations who exist with the express purpose of putting power back into the hands of the papacy, ultimately. But even with all of their efforts, this beast that once was still is. Yet we think that it is not. It is. It is comprised of names and people that you will typically never, ever, ever hear of. It's the beast that was and is not, yet is present. And it has had an image made unto itself by the second beast of Revelation 13. You do some homework, have a set of spiritual eyes, you figure out who that beast is too, in no time. So, anyways, a little bit of a rabbit trail there when he had called INC the beast. But, yeah. So, again, back to Laudato Si, echoing all of these things that we are seeing from John Truman Wolfe's publication, Anatomy of a Con Job, that all of these things that he's talking about, that he's going on for like 300 points, and each point well over a paragraph long, typically. And it's mind-numbing. All predicated on a lie. And there's some really interesting things, though. You know, the Pope brings up in Laudato Si, he has the gall to bring up Romans 8:19. Because, of course, he's calling the earth our mother and our sister, and how awful we are to our mother and our sister. And it's just as rotten gets. But let's put Romans 8:19 into some context here, and we can see that starting in Romans 12, what Paul is saying here, he says, "So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are children of God. For you didn't receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which will be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to vanity, not of its own will, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of decay into the liberty of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. Not only so, but ourselves also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for that which he sees? But if we hope for that which we don't see, we wait for it with patience. So in context, Paul is saying that even the creation groans for what? Well, it would be for the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is what is going to see all of the glory. It says the glory of the children of God, for the harvest to be complete, for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to return and to remake this creation. And it's not something that we have to look at and say, well, that then is man's responsibility to somehow affect this thing. No, this thing will be done at the return of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. We can find out a little bit more if we go to 2 Peter 3, where Peter, talking about the scoffers in the last days, he says, knowing this first, that in the last days mockers will come, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For from the days that the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. For this they willingly forget, that there were heavens from of old, and an earth formed out of water, and amid water, by the word of God, by which means the world was then, that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens that now are, and the earth, by the same word, have been stored up for fire, being reserved against the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. But don't forget this one thing, beloved, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slow concerning his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient with us, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fervent heat, and the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be destroyed like this, what kind of people ought you to be in holy living and godliness, looking for and earnestly desiring the coming of the day of God, which will cause the burning heavens to be dissolved, and the elements will melt with fervent heat? But according to his promise, we look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Now, if this Pope cared anything about humanity, he would be following the Lord Jesus Christ right now. He would be taking these massive, massive holdings that the Vatican has, and he would be distributing to the hungry of the world. You could feed the hungry of the world probably thousands of times over with all of the wealth that the Vatican holds. Between them and all of the holdings of their Jesuit army that they have amassed over 500 years, all of the black nobility of Europe that are in league with them, by the way, and all of their secretive arms and wings organizations that report directly to the Pope or the Black Pope, organizations like the CIA and others, there wouldn't be the problems there are now. This isn't about what's going on with the environment of the world. This is about curtailing a population that could quite easily, when instigated, rise up and absolutely decimate these people. There's good reasons why they're building all of their underground military bases, things like that. There's really good reason for it. Because if I understand the Bible correctly, if I understand the book of Revelation even remotely correctly, there is an earthquake, which is an upheaval, political upheaval. And we know that those things are usually precipitated by war. And we can understand that the hailstone spoken of, about the weight of a talent, talents around 50 pounds, would be armies. Now, I don't know exactly what John's implying when he says that these hailstones would be so large. If it would be a battle so great that the hail would seem so large and so heavy, and send men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail. And that seems to be the way of it. Now, what interest I want to inspire in you a bit. After seeing what we've just seen between Romans 8, 2 Peter 3, what we're starting to understand about what oil is. By the way, I'm going to bring this up, though I don't have the Wikipedia pages up on it. It's really easy to find. In general, oil is classified into a couple of classifications. You have sour crude oil and sweet crude oil. The difference between the two is the amount of sulfur. And no matter if oil is sweet or sour, it has a sulfur content. It's just that the sweet oil sulfur content is a bit lower than the sour crude oil sulfur content, but it's all full of sulfur. You ask anyone to describe crude oil, one of the chief aspects of the description is the sulfurous rotten egg smell of oil. So it's just packed with sulfur. We can see that honest scientists and geologists are telling us that oil is the second most abundant liquid on Earth, or in Earth. Full of sulfur, crude oil burns very well, very well, very easily. Keep that in mind. When I started this Deceptions of the Beasts a few weeks ago, I believe I read from Revelation 13. Now, I find it kind of interesting what we just talked about with Russia and things that are going on with Russia and China. I find to be very interesting. Because thus far, I see China and Russia in certain ways to be tension points for the two current great beast powers of the earth. And as for right now, I'm still staying with the model that sees the vials of Revelation 16 as being poured out over a great period of time. Not too great, but great enough. They would have to be poured out from the time that there was even this second beast on the earth that we see in Revelation 13, which is also referred to later on, we're going to see, as the false prophet. So it would have to be recent things. I believe these are the last plagues. These are the end time plagues. The bowls being poured out. It says, "And the sixth messenger did pour out his vial upon the great river, the Euphrates, and dried up was its water, that the way of the kings who are from the rising of the sun may be made ready." And I think Russia and China fit that bill pretty well. It's my opinion. This is why I've called many times for people to look into prophecy. If you're a futurist, or even if you're a preterist, to look at your model, to criticize it, to see if it stands up. In the light of what Peter tells us, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. Does preterism and futurism fall under that categorization of private interpretation? I think if you look into them closely, critically, you'll find they do. And verse 13, I saw, by the way, I'm in Young's Literal Translation. I find that very interesting, Young's Literal Translation, to read it from time to time. Starting in verse 13, and I saw come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet, three unclean spirits like frogs. For they are spirits of demons, doing signs which go forth unto the kings of the earth, and of the whole world, to bring them together to the battle of the great day of God the Almighty. Lo, I do come as a thief. Happy is he who is watching and keeping his garments, that they may not walk naked, and that they may see his unseemliness. And they did bring them together to the place that is called in Hebrew Armageddon, the Valley of Megiddo. Jesse Vassell talked about this recently. And he did, I think, a very good job with Megiddo and what we are to understand concerning Megiddo, the Hill of Megiddo, and the Valley of Megiddo, where ancient battles were fought, the crossroads of the ancient world. It is where every army and every merchant would cross when traveling between the two great powers of the ancient world, being Assyria and Egypt. I would look into that. And I think Robert Caringola has some very good things to say about it as well. Don't think that we're talking about something that's physically going to take place in Megiddo. That would be impossible. It would be utterly, absolutely impossible. We're talking about a book of signs and symbols. And remember, before you start thinking, like Tex Mars does, that the spirits of frogs are going to be the demonic alien prison guards in the New World Order's FEMA concentration camps, the frogs part of it, the only reference I've found to frogs are in the plagues of Egypt and how plentiful they were and how they saturated everyone's lives. Now, I'm not saying the FEMA concentration camps may never be used or anything like that. I'm saying in part that I'd be concerned about anything that Tex Mars taught. A. And I've got a lot of reason for that. A lot of reason for that. Anybody who vouches for Alex Jones, for one thing. And that also includes, by the way, Stan Monteith, while he was still alive, and I know he's gone now, but he did vouch for him very plainly, very publicly, very vehemently, and more than once. So I'd be very careful about him too. Which, by the way, side note, Stan Monteith was doing his longtime radio show. Side note, the one of the people that was doing a lot of this broadcasting with Stan Monteith was none other than James Corbett. These guys who are not pinpointing the problem, they talk oftentimes in generalities. And I think many of the things that they bring up confuse the issue more than clarify it. Just saying. Okay, and let's move on from there. I'm already over an hour on my video. No big deal, but you know, I've got to get to work. So moving on from there, there's something that, and this is the part where I would really, really like to I'd really like to get you thinking. And that's really a lot of what I'm trying to do here. I told everybody I am not assuming a position over anyone as a teacher or anything. I am here as your brother. I want to inspire you. I want to get you thinking about certain things. I want to encourage you. Anyone out there, especially the historicists in the crowd, and if you're not one, look into it and find out if your model stands up. Because without the right eschatology, everything else falls. And is the right eschatology a salvific issue? No, you can be saved, I think, no matter what eschatology you've been, let's say you've been raised to believe, or what eschatology the assembly that you happen to find yourself in believes. But I do find it very confusing that someone who's saved, who is filled with the Spirit of Truth, would stay in such a clearly wrong system. And I want to say wrong because there's a lot of other things I could say about it, but just wrong. As futurism and preterism, without being eventually led out of it. So I'd ask you to really examine your eschatology models. And even if you're a historicist, examine it and scrutinize it, because there are a lot of historicists out there. Don't fool yourself. Just because we're historicists doesn't mean that every bit of material that's been put out there has been put out by genuine Christians. You know, if the Jesuits put out plenty of publications since the 16th century trying to lead people away from the historicist view of Revelation, then you can bet your bottom dollar that they've been putting out all kinds of stuff in the meantime trying to get historicists confused on the message of Revelation and Daniel. So scrutinize and criticize your model if you're a historicist also. So here's what I want to bring up. Everything that we've learned today about what oil actually is and its plentitude on this planet, when we can start understanding who the false prophet is, the second beast of Revelation 13. And yes, I've been waiting, and I'm not just coming out and talking about it as if it is what it is, because I think people have to examine this, and they have to make up their minds for themselves, just like I had to do. I had to come to this on my own. I listened to what others said. I had to study and look and see the signs and what made the most sense. But when you start understanding these things, then consider once again, when we see the vision of Christ coming on the white horse in Revelation 19, and it says starting in verse 17, "And I saw one messenger standing in the sun. And he cried a great voice, saying to all the birds that are flying in mid-heaven, come and be gathered together to the supper of the great God, that ye may eat flesh of kings and flesh of chiefs of thousands and flesh of strong men and flesh of horses and of those sitting on them and the flesh of all free men and servants, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies, having been gathered together to make war with him who is sitting upon the horse and with his army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet, who did the signs before him, in which he led astray those who did receive the mark of the beast, and those who did bow before his image. Living they were cast, the two, to the lake of fire that is burning with brimstone, which is sulfur. and the rest were killed with the sword of him who is sitting on the horse, which sword is proceeding out of his mouth, and all the birds were filled out of their flesh. So once you consider that, and you can look in a lot of translations, you're going to see right there, or you can just look up brimstone and what brimstone is made of. It's heavily sulfurous. The lake of fire, it's burning with sulfur. It's burning with brimstone. Oil has a high sulfur content. We see from 2 Peter 3, the creation is being stored up for fire. I want us to begin to try to understand what we're being told in the revelation of Jesus Christ concerning his return, the resurrection of the dead unto eternal life. These beasts, the false prophet, their judgment, and what's to become of the world when he returns. Who these figures are, and what it means to us. We need to understand who the harlot is in Revelation 17. We need to make sure that we aren't one of her daughters. So eschatology, it is important. Eschatology is of the utmost importance. Because if you don't have the right eschatology, then you may see a lot of this spiritual harlotry that's being committed, not just in the Roman Catholic Church. She has many, many daughters. You might see that as inconsequential. God does not see that as inconsequential. And Jesus said to keep my commandments as I have kept my Father's commandments, and I will abide in you. He says, abide in my word. My Father and I will come, and we will make our home with you. And if we are participating in religious practices and worship practices and institutions who profane the word of God and who disregard the law of God and who make others their master, I don't care if they are their master before Christ or if he has to share joint ownership, he isn't pleased, and it's harlotry. So eschatology is important. So at a minute 12, or an hour 12, not a minute 12, an hour 12, I'm going to wrap it up for the day. The next thing we're getting to, section 3, is going to help to even further cement the nefarious nature of the papacy and the ideas that they are pushing and the downright evils of the environmental movement and the Sierra Club and guys like Al Gore, part of the Club of Rome, and everything else. And we're going to try to continue to tie all of these things together so that we can better understand the nature of the deception of the beasts in these last days, who God himself says in Revelation chapter 13 that second beast, who makes the image of the first beast, he says that it deceives my own people on the earth, and I'm here to do everything that I can to stop that deception with as many as I can. So I would say today, may everyone have a fantastic day. Praise God. Praise God the Father. Praise the only begotten Son of God, our Lord Jesus Christ. May they be blessed and praised above all. And may our lives absolutely echo their goodness, their love, their holiness, their purity. And may we all follow Christ, the Lamb of God, wherever he goes. So until next time, I bid you all peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.